Jeff Fettig is the chairman and CEO of Whirlpool Corporation, and he's also our board chair at Business Leaders for Michigan. Whirlpool, I think as most of you know, is the world's leading manufacturer and marketer of major home appliances, with revenues of nearly $20 billion, nearly 70,000 employees, and 59 manufacturing and technology centers around the world. Jeff joined Whirlpool back in 1981 and has held a number of positions with the company both here and also overseas. He also serves on the boards of the Dow Chemical Company, the Indiana University Foundation, and a personal passion of his, the Board of Governors for the Boys and Girls Clubs of America. Jeff works all over the globe and has some terrific insights that he can share with us. So let me welcome Jeff Fettig. Jeff?
I'll say hello, Michigan, because we've got a lot of great Michigan companies represented here today. You know, look at this title that Doug gave me, The Accelerated Pace of Change in the Marketplace, How to Survive and Thrive. You know, when he sent me this, I said, wow, that's a big topic. And how do you want me to address it? He said, however you want. So that was my direction. So the way I wanted to do it is, and hopefully with a little of your involvement, is really address, you know, all of you in business or organizations that have been around a long time. Just maybe a quick check. How many people's businesses in this room are over 20 years old? Oh, wow, a lot, more than half. I would argue that you've changed your business a number of times during that 20 years. And so, you know, I'm gonna talk a little bit about change, but more about the rate of change, and more importantly, kind of the mindset that we as a company are trying to develop on how we've got to change ourselves to stay in step with the rate of change that we see in the global marketplace. This week was kind of a special week for us. On Tuesday, the 11th, we celebrated our 103rd anniversary, and we call ourselves 103 years young. Thank you. The picture on the left, real very quickly, is in the 19 teens. I don't know what year it was, but the early days of Whirlpool. This is one of our founders, Lou Upton, was the company's chief salesperson. This was his showroom, and he literally used to go around and demonstrate what this new fangled electric washer thing was and sell them out of the back of the truck. And I think in the first year or so, we sold 200 units. On the right is our global or our North America headquarters here in Michigan with the big showroom on the front. And today, globally, we sell over 60 million appliances a year. That translates into two appliances every second. So basically, in 2 minutes, we've sold more than we did the first year of the company. So that's a lot of change. Reinventing ourselves. How many of you in your current business, where your primary product today is the exact same product it was 10 years ago? Anybody? A lot of people probably, some? A lot of people know. Well, ours is no different. We started out with a single product, a single customer. We're an OEM manufacturer for 35 years. Then we went to multi-product, that lasted for 35 years. And then multi-brand, then globalization. But look at the last 8 years. Let me back up. Excuse me. Back up. There we go. In this first era, I want to say we were about $300 million. In the second era, by 1980, when I started with the company, we're at $2.2 billion. By the end of the 1980s, we're about $5 billion. And then when we decided to globalize, I'll tell you a very interesting story. It's how I first learned what a BHAG was. My predecessor, new into his role as chairman and CEO, spent quite a bit of time with his team developing a new strategy. And that strategy was to go global. They thought the world was becoming global, and that for us to survive and prosper, we had to readily expand and rapidly expand in all major markets around the world. And at that time, Asia was still a little bit of a closed market, so it was primarily Europe, Latin America, and all parts in between. At that time, which was in the mid-80s, we were number two in the U.S. We had 95% of our sales in the U.S. And here we have this new chairman, CEO, talking about a vision of becoming, not only going global, but becoming the global leader of the major appliance industry. And I was a young guy then. I thought, wow, that's pretty extraordinary. But the most extraordinary thing was, as he had a major strategy session with all of his key people, about 25 people in the room, and he kind of went through the rationale and all the work they had done and so on and so forth, he looked around the room and he said, of the 25 people, how many of you have passports? Three people raised their hands. So that's what I call a big, hairy, audacious goal when you're sitting in Benton Harbor, Michigan, talking about becoming a global company. But we didn't know any better, so we did it. And the decade of the 90s, again, we doubled the company. We acquired, made acquisitions in Europe. We bought out our joint ventures in Mexico, Canada, Brazil, and we entered into Asia, India, and China for the first time ever. Again, the decade of the 90s, we doubled the size of the company. As I look at this, 30 years, 10 years, those were all reinventing ourselves period of time. And if you talk to the people in those eras, they will talk about the traumatic change they had to go through to reinvent the company. I would argue, though, that the rate of change now, it has been accelerating ever since then. Because since 2006, when we had the opportunity to acquire Maytag, then, like all of you, we went through the Great Recession, which for all of us in our working careers have never experienced a period of time like it. In our business, our market demand went down 30% in the United States. We had no records ever for a market that went down 30%. But we survived, we thrived, and fortunately made through it without being hurt as a company. More recently, in fact, in the last year, we just acquired a leading company in Europe, Indesit, in Hefei Sanyo in China. So again, in the last 8 years, profound change. We will double the, in fact, we have doubled the size of our company from 2014 versus 2006. So I really define these five periods as the periods in our 103-year history where we've redefined ourselves. What is happening, as you can see here, though, is the rate this is changing is increasing at an increasing rate. And I talk to our folks that basically, I think the cycle times now are about 5 or 6 years, that no matter what industry you're in, what business you're in, if you're not thinking how to be radically better and different in a 5 or 6 year period of time, someone else is probably doing that. So with this in mind, you know, where are we today? This year is gonna be our best year ever. We're gonna have record revenues, record earnings, significant. We were already number one in the world. We're gonna have a much stronger position. Record stock price, which is always good. So you look at that and say, gee, things are going okay. So what do you worry about? I don't know about all of you, I'm sure it's true, but when I talk to young people, new employees, students on campuses, I think there's one standard CEO question they always ask, and that's this: what keeps you up at night? And I used to say, oh, nothing, I sleep really well. I used to say, well, I only worry about the things I can control, so if I can control them, I should do something about them, and therefore I'll sleep. So I had all these interesting sort of answers. But the fact of the matter is, there is one thing that keeps me up at night. And I brought a little prop to show you. It's this. Did any of you ever have one of these? Okay, one of the first, I don't even know if we called it a cell phone, it was a portable phone. This is Motorola. It doesn't fit in my pocket. It's pretty good for working out. It's got a 30-minute battery, and it had spotty reception. It was very expensive. But I would argue this was the beginning of changing the world for many companies and many industries. And this is what keeps me up at night. Why is this? We use, however you want to define it, telecommunications, telephone, smartphone, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We use this as the living example of how you can never not only be complacent, but how you have to always be looking out for change coming from places you may never expect. And this is every year we take our leadership through a lesson like this. If you look at these phones, I think I've owned all these phones at some period of time. I will ask you a question. How many of you in this room today, in your home or apartment, have a landline? Okay, hands down. How many don't? Wow. Wow. Nationally, it's 40%. I think this room's at least equal to the national average. One other question. For those of you who have kids, because we got some younger folks here, how many of your children have landlines? I have two adult children. I don't think they've ever had a landline. Who would have thought that? What's really intriguing when you study the evolution of this industry, and there's a lot of way to do it, is rapid changes, changing cycles, and how short industry leadership has lasted for a number of companies. And I'm not picking on any of these companies. They've all did great things and so on, but you know, the fact of the matter is Motorola kind of broke ground, created the cell phone business. I had my first phone was a Motorola. Nokia came along and beat them at their game, and they took over market leadership. I had a Nokia phone. Then BlackBerry came along and changed the functionality of what a cell phone was used for, and I was a BlackBerry user. I held on being a BlackBerry user until 2 years ago, then I finally had to give it up. And then Apple came along and completely redefined the experience, completely obliterated the experience of what a cell phone became, a smart device, and many other things. And has held the lead for a long time. In fact, arguably, they held the lead until 2012. And then someone else came along called Samsung, who was there all along, but they were coming up. I think last year, 2013, part of 2012, people say Samsung was the clear, global, undisputed leader of smart devices last year. This year, Apple's come back, reclaimed the upper end of the market. There's a company, I don't know if you've ever heard of them, Xiaomi, a Chinese company, number one smartphone seller in China. Did not exist 4.5 years ago. $12 billion company today. Has killed the other guys on price competition. Samsung, who was the market leader, all-time record profits last year, 75% decline in profitability in the third quarter this year. That's how fast things change. So today there's over 6 billion cell phone subscribers in an estimated global population of 7.2. In 100 countries, there's more cell phone subscribers than there are people. Wish that was true in appliances. The number of industries, and talking about forces and power coming from nowhere that are hard to anticipate, you know, think about the impact this has had on the camera industry, the PC industry, all forms of entertainment, radio, newspaper, print, retail. And you could probably have 5 more pages of this. It's been profound. And I don't know how anybody could have anticipated this even 10 years ago. So how does that impact us? And I would argue, and that's why we use this a lot internally in our company is, you know, I really don't care if you're in the technology business, the service business, or the products business. I would argue that the time that we all have today to reinvent ourselves for the future is decreasing because there's so many different elements coming at us in a rapid way that we don't have, I don't have the luxury, and I'll show you in a moment, of doing the same thing for 30 years anymore, or 20 years, or even 10 years. There's too many forces that are changing that. So in appliances, I'll just give you a couple of views of this. you know, as it relates to smart stuff, I mean, we've had the technology and the ability to connect remotely communications to our appliances for 15 years or more. Okay, so that, none of that part's new. You know, the cost curves have come down and so on and so forth. But, you know, about 2008, we all were talking about smart appliances. And then 2 years, literally 2 years later, it was all about digitalization and digital appliances. 2012, all we talked about was connectivity. About a year or so ago, we started about talking about the Internet of Things. What do these things mean? I don't know. I really don't know. They're all kind of the same thing. And I think if we surveyed 400 people in this room, we'd get 400 answers on what these things mean. But basically, it's the ability to add more value to our products, to control them remotely, and get more services from them, in the simplest sense. So what we're doing is it's led us over time to really expand our collaboration with others. 10 years ago, we used to get all of our ideas from customers, through customer research, and through our employees. Today, we've built a systematic collaboration network with a lot of companies. These are just a few. Detergent companies, food companies, beverage companies, universities, billing companies, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And we have active innovation collaboration workshops with them all the time, because together we're trying to say, is there something you do and something I do that we jointly can do better that gives a better outcome to the customer? And the answer a lot of times, yes. Then that's the easy part. The hard part is figuring out how you make it work. And that's why it's hard work. You know, with that, we've done things like, we do have iAppliances. We're the first company in the world to put in the marketplace a completely connected suite of kitchen appliances, all that you can control from the internet, your cell phone, whatever. We have out there the first iWasher, and it can do literally all these things if that's what the consumer wants. You can register your product on, you know, with your phone. You don't have to throw your use and care guide away or in a drawer that you'll never find again. You can pull it up online. You can turn it off and on if that's what you want to do. You can do remote diagnostics and so on and so forth. And it really is a cool washer. It's slick. It does have our latest technology. And there is a segment of consumers who want the latest technology available, and they're willing to pay for it, because this product costs about 50% more than the average washing machine. But you can do a lot with it. Is it a big volume for us today? No. But if nothing else, it's experimentation for us to learn better what consumers want. What people really want still today is more like depicted in our most recent brand campaign, which I'll show you. And this is really how most of our consumers who buy our products actually act today.
What happened?
How did you make this?
What is this? How did you get up there?
You did what?
How did it go?
What?
How in the?
What did you do?
Honey, how did that happen?
Wake up!
What? How? What?
Asking the right questions, that's caring. And that's why Whirlpool made the new Cabrio washer with settings that simply ask what and how to get the perfect wash. Every day, care. Whirlpool.
So we ask ourselves the question, you know, do we want to go all down the technology route, or do we all want to go down the route where people want, they want the technology, but they want it in a simple application, one touch, whatever. You know, our view, we got to do both. You know, we may be diverging, and eventually it will converge, but we have to push the technology, but we're not selling technology for the sake of technology. We're delivering that technology in the form of consumer solutions. And that's our big learning, that we keep recycling these technology capabilities into trying to find tangible and powerful consumer benefits. So, what do we have to do to deal in this kind of world? Well, one, we got to keep being really good at what we do. The leader in our industry, having the best products all the time. Example here is our new four-door French door refrigerator. It's a beautiful product. simple factoid. It uses as much energy in 1 year as a 60-watt light bulb. New front load washer and dryer, 20% bigger, biggest thing you've ever had, possibly can wash with, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It uses 70% less water, 70% less energy, and treats your clothes better. That's what having the best appliances are. Let me talk about cycle times. Really, probably the most critical thing we see in our business. You know, I showed you the historical picture in the beginning. This first wringer washer, which was a gear technology to electric motor. That technology, although the products changed a lot, in some shape or form, was the fundamental platform for almost 50 years for electric washing machines for us in the United States. We revolutionized that in the 60s by bringing out a belt drive suspension, which connected the motor to the tub, if you will. That lasted for 25 years. When I started with the company in the early 1980s, it was a huge thing in the company. We were introducing this new fantastic direct drive, and it was. It took away the belt, it put the gear straight into the motor, which drove the tub. It took 10 years to develop in R&D and engineering. It took us 5 years to phase out the old, phase in the new. 15 years from idea to fully implemented. Biggest thing ever in the history of the company in that period of time. We obsoleted all that 4 years ago by bringing out the Oasis design, which is a radical new design that, in short, provides the same or better benefits in a top load washer that you get in the European horizontal or front load washer. A fabulous product, been wonderfully successful. But we've obsoleted that. We're just now, you saw it in the commercial, we're just started in September shipping. A new product, absolutely new technology design, has taken us 22 months from idea to shipping. That's how we measure now, idea to shipping. So we've gone from 50 years, 25 years, 20 years, 4 years, 22 months, and we think that's still long. So the cycle times for us to reinvent our products is decreasing, and we have to do it in a way that we don't spend the $100 million of capital every time we have a major project. We're also doing a lot of things across our other businesses. Hopefully you recognize the iconic KitchenAid stand mixer on the left. 15 years ago, we sold over 500,000 of these here in the United States. You could have anything you wanted as long as it was white. Today, we sell 27 different colors. We've expanded it into a whole line of iconic KitchenAid products in virtually every color you want. This has grown to be well over a $1 billion business for us. It's a global business, and it's growing double digits every year. We're bringing new business models out. I talked about collaboration. This is a joint venture we have with Procter & Gamble. It's called the Swash, or the Swasher, if you will. It's basically everything you're wearing today, unless you spill something on yourself at lunch and get a stain, you could go home tonight or in the morning while you shower, put your jacket, your shirt, your trousers in the Swasher. It will de-wrinkle, refresh, deodorize, and you can wear it the next day to work. 80% of what people take to dry cleaners, this does at home. It has a pod system that by Procter & Gamble that delivers the chemistry, a spray system, it slides in, slides out, takes 10 minutes. Completely new business model for us, just on the market in the last month. In Brazil, $499. But for you, it's available at Bloomingdale's, Bed Bath & Beyond, Best Buy, or call me. In Brazil, another exciting new product. We think the world's first, to our knowledge, ever, hot, cold, carbonated, still, at-home beverage dispensing. It will make great coffee. It will make great hot tea. It will make iced tea. It will make colas. It will make orange juice, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We're working with beverage producers there for the pods. This is something that we think has a chance to revolutionize beverage dispensing in the home. And lastly, new business models, innovation, important part of how we try to stay ahead of the game. We are in the appliance business, but we're also in the consumer products business. So we go through an innovation process all the time, looking at through different lenses. About 10 years ago, one of our teams was looking at every room in the house and saying, how can Whirlpool innovate and be in every room in the house? And of course, the biggest room in the house is the garage. And the only Whirlpool product that most people had in their garages at that time were your old rusted refrigerator, which, by the way, is highly inefficient, and you should get rid of anyway. But that was our only presence. And so we first thought about garage appliances. And that was okay with consumers, not a big hit. But as we studied this, clearly what came out was garages are a mess. I was shocked. I mean, I know mine was, but 50% of Americans can't get their cars in garages because it's so messy, or at least one of their cars. So we went about developing Gladiator Garage Works, which is a garage storage system. On the upper left, and this, I didn't plant this, you guys did the survey before, this is Tom Izzo's garage in the upper left. It's actually not that messy compared to most people's. This is what it looks like on the bottom two things. And up in the right hand, of course, Tom's happy now, and because of that, I'm sure he's gonna have a more successful basketball team. Working with Tom actually gave us another idea. If you would have told me 5 years ago we're gonna be in the sports locker business, I would have said, what? We're in the sports locker business with Gladiator Garage. We just signed an agreement with the NCAA to, if you want, we not only can gladiatorize your garage, we can give you the sport lockers of your teams and as many lockers as you want. As part of this system. So, the point of all this, into the topic, surviving and thriving and hopefully prospering during accelerated change in the global marketplace. You know, there's three things we talk to our folks about all the time that we can't ever forget. One, we are in the business to serve and create value for our customers. And if that's our beacon. If we ever lose sight of that, we're gonna go off track. Number two, the world is changing. We got to adapt fast, change fast, and move fast. And that's a full-time job, helping the organization figure out how to do that. And lastly, and this is true today, it was true 10 years ago, it was probably true 103 years ago, you got to be the best at what you do. And we define best as the value we offer to consumers in the most efficient way. And that's the operational mentality of our business. So generally, we're finding this requires reinventing ourselves, obsoleting ourselves. Maybe just to summarize, you know, I would say the following. You know, we all know the world is changing, whether we like it or not. And I think that's a constant communication to the masses of our population of employees. Change is good as an attitude, but it's not a normal one. The normal attitude is change is bad. So all of us, and we certainly try to do, is to build an organization that embraces and seeks change. And lastly, be prepared to obsolete yourself, because if you don't, somebody else is going to do it. And I think this ultimately boils down to leadership. There's a lot of great leadership sayings. This is one I particularly like. Leadership, the catalyst for positive change. Catalyst means you got to do something. Positive, for me, is better than negative, and you got to change. And if I were to add one thing, so I'd say fast. So thank you for the opportunity to share these thoughts with you, and I hope we all have a great day. Thank you very much.